Okay, welcome to Social Media Fridays. Each week we meet to wind down and talk about what happened in the world of social media in the previous 7 days. With us today we have Edwin Yonk. He's CEO of IDISHosts.nl in the Netherlands. And Masataki Wasa. Masataki is a Google top contributor on the AdSense and the Google Plus Help community, and he's also webmaster of wasaweb.net in the UK. First question we have today is was posted by Maher Begat. And it was a post of Jana Nystrom's on updated notification changes. I hardly use notifications, Masataki, so I'm going to throw this to you.
I think it's a relatively, if I may say, old inverted commas change that was introduced a while back, in which when someone adds you on Google Plus, you get notified. It used to be a case that whoever added you, there was a counter increase on the notifications, and the person will have a card, and you can expand and then see, you know, who that person who has followed you is. Now there seems to be two different types of followers. Some who do get notifications, some who will cause the notifications to go up, so the number on Mr. Jingles, the bell, will go up, and others who are grouped under everything else. Now, it seems to me, and this is purely impressionistic personal experience rather than anything that I've read or heard or seen, if you have any social connections or strong social connections with the person who has added you, then that person will have a prominent notification. Whereas if you've been added by someone whom you don't know or you don't have social connections, then they're grouped under everything else, and they don't really appear strongly in that it doesn't cause the notification number to go up, and you will have to expand that everything else card to see who has added you. Does that make sense?
It only counts for people that added you or also events?
It's a good question. I have only seen this with regard to people adding me on my own account.
Because from memory, I think I saw an event once or twice there. Because maybe that I hit maybe instead of yes. I'm not sure.
That's possible. I think the... I don't know how exactly it works, but it does seem to be the case that Google is now making sure that there are two types or two classes of notifications. Ones that it assumes that you'd be interested, so that the bell, Mr. Jingles number, goes up, and those that are grouped as everything else that you might not be particularly interested in. So it is, I'm not certain, but I think Google Plus is essentially sorting things out. It's one way of sorting the more important things, more important notifications, more important additions, and those that are not that important.
I'm sure that within that everything else, there some posts are there because people have pinged you in. And you don't have any social connection to them, or you don't have friended them, or. And yeah. I'm pretty sure that one will be in the everything else too. especially if a post is public and they just send it out to so many people that it's quite annoying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes perfect sense to me.
Yes, I like everything else.
Okay, have we covered this one?
Yeah, I think so.
All right, this one is an interesting one. How Instagram's drug deals go undetected. I did read this article. Basically, drug dealers are using keywords on Instagram to sell both illegal and pharmacy drugs via Instagram. And you can see by the screenshot there, a poster on Instagram is advertising Xanax for sale. I don't know what Xanax does. I thought it was interesting. Once upon a time, we had a website on the internet called Silk Road, which was doing much the same thing and using Bitcoin to evade detection. Not sure if they're using Bitcoin on Instagram, but it's something that according to the article, Instagram is not policing this, and apart from it in the most shallow way, and it looks like it's a trade that is growing. Personally, I think all drugs should be legalized and decriminalized.
Well, according to the article, they use this system used alongside Bitcoin, Kick, and Google Voice allows illicit products to move with a surprising amount of security and ease. So they are using Bitcoin in combination with Instagram and Google Voice. Never heard of Kick.
What about you, Masataki? Where do you buy your drugs?
Oh, you mean my coffee from my local coffee shop? And coffee shop, not in the Dutch sense of the word. But, you know, I think any platform is going to be used by various different peoples, and I think, in a sense, it's a cat and mouse game for Instagram, isn't it? Because people are using codes, you know, hidden language, things like that. They're using things that might be totally legitimate on the looks of it. You know, you can't simply ban something which might be actually a legitimate thing or a legitimate word or a legitimate series of words, which are hidden codes and keywords and things like that for people in the know. So I think it's obviously platforms such as Instagram and others, you know, have a duty to make sure that their platform is free of illegal materials. If that's the case. But I don't think it's necessarily an easy way, or there is an easy way to sort this out.
Well, they are using hashtags, so they're not really hiding, are they?
Yeah, I mean, if you're using, you know, hashtag name of the drug, then yeah. But what if it's a code? You know, many drugs go by different names.
Yes, they use all the street language.
Yeah, so let's say in combination of different words, each on their own, maybe totally innocent, maybe an everyday word, in combination it means something to those in the know. Now, how do you go about finding those out and stamping those out? It can be quite difficult. And then once you manage to find something out and then you put a stop to it, they're going to find another code to replace it. So I think it's a tough situation for the platforms. Obviously they should make an effort, but I think this is sort of eternal cat and mouse situation.
Fair enough. All right. Would you like to move to the next one? I'm going to record that as a yes. This is one that I didn't get time to look at. I posted it on the Social Media Fridays community. By the way, if you're watching at home, you can add anything you have found in the world of social media to the Social Media Fridays community, and we'll talk about it at our regular Friday hangout. And you're welcome to join us, and we'd love to discuss it with you. But this is 14 social media tools recommended by the pros. I don't know who the pros might be, but no doubt, I'm sure there's plenty of people that want to claim the title. I can't think of 15 metrics that I'd want to measure in social media, but I suppose I'm just a Luddite. What are your thoughts on this, guys? I can wait as long as you want.
Well, it feels a little random to me. I mean, it sounds like, oh, we asked 14 people to list what they use. So if we go through, excuse me, each product, the first one is Quirl Engage, for automatic Google Analytics report. Never used it. Never heard of it, actually, so can't really say. Number two, Bulk Buffer, for bulk update scheduling. So I suppose that's useful if you are scheduling a large number of posts using Buffer. And my screen froze, so I don't know what night after number three.
Number three is Post Planner for scheduled Facebook posts. It's an app built in Facebook. I never used it. The fourth one is Bundle Post for curated content tweets. Bundle Post is the one that immediately stands out. I never heard of that either. Number fifth is GitHub. Not sure how to use that for social media. Six is PhotoSync for sharing photos across devices. It's an app that lets you quickly share photos between your computer and mobile device. not sure where the social connection is there, but it's mentioned. King Sumu for better blog headlines. It's an A-B test thing for titles, I think. This WordPress plugin. I never used it. Personally, because I don't like to have multiple plugins in WordPress. Just a couple, and that's enough for me. Tech port for hashtag management. TechBoard is a hashtag-based search engine that lets you see mentions and related content across most social platforms. That can be useful. I'm sure if Google Plus is in TechBoard. Let me check. Do you recognize anyone, Jim?
No, I don't subscribe to. I mean, as you know, I'm no social media genius anyway. But if I ever aspired to become one, I wouldn't agree with the concept of timing your posts to a particular time because they happen to get more engagement than another time. Because you know, I just don't think that the logic is behind it is well founded. A particular post might get more comments, but that could be from the makeup of the people that have circled you. And I personally just post it at random. If a post comes out and it's good, I post it then. I don't wait till later till somebody else has reposted it five or six times and end up looking old hat and second hand. If I see something that is of value that I want to share with my friends, that's when I do it, as soon as I see it. I just do not see the logic in waiting for a particular time to send it out because I know that some people will be awake at that time. So yeah, most of these tools, these scheduling tools and Buffer and that, I don't see the value in them. I think a lot of it is hype. I mean, it's one of the things you can control. So therefore, here's a function, let's build a tool around it. But, you know, I think they're building these tools for the sake of building these tools. Social media isn't long-term manipulable. It's a living thing. And if you're not a genuine person, you'll still. I mean, there are still ways to attract people, as you know, all three of us know. You could pull 100,000 subscribers just by manipulating circles. But those people are of no use to you. You're wasting their time and yours because they're not your audience. You get your audience through normal human interactions. The social platform is just part of just a tool that you're using to make that communication happen. That's what I think, anyway.
Yeah, with regard to techboard.com, they basically track the hashtags of multiple social platforms. It includes Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Google+. Fine, and another one. The problem with these tools is mostly because they are too slow. They're too slow to crawl the API, and you're basically running behind. If you want to do on an event like a soccer game or a hockey game or what have you, you want to reply ASCP. So with tools like TechBoard, you're running behind. If you want to use it that way, that is.
Actually, I misspoke before. I do use four social media tools. I use a fantastic tool by Isan. I can't think of his surname. Good heavens, I can see his face in front of me. Isan has built a magnificent tool called Circloscope. And I use that on Google Plus because it annoys me when people circle you, and I, you know, dutifully circle them back. Then 2 days later, they've uncircled you, so they can got another 5,000 people in circle them. So I use Circloscope to just cull those people on a regular basis. And there's another one that I use called Tweepit, I think, T-W-E-E-P-I-T, Tweepit, which is a Twitter tool doing exactly the same thing. I do that just to stop people from taking advantage of me. And there's another tool I use, it's called Microsoft Social Listening, and this is a crawler which crawls Facebook and Twitter, but I don't use it for Facebook, I don't bother with Facebook, but I do use it for Twitter and blog posts, and so it does crawl Blogger and also WordPress, it's crawling looking for keywords related to our businesses, and I use it because I don't have more than 24 hours in the day, and it goes out and does my reading for me, pulls in the posts that are relevant. They might be positive or negative, and lets me go directly to that particular post and respond. And the other one that I'm just about to start using is a new tool which will be out soon called Microsoft Delve, D-E-L-V. I made a post on Google Plus about 2 weeks ago about it. I think it's due to be released in January 15, and it basically it looks around your sphere of influence to see what people that you're related to are posting, whether it be PowerPoint slides or slides, share slides, white papers, reports, anything that might be useful to you. And then, again, like the social listening tool, you configure it to fit into your interests. But, I can see that's going to save some time, and certainly social listening is a definite time saver. It means that I can virtually ignore Twitter, but for the things I'm interested in. I have a plan for getting the Damasio questions panelists onto Microsoft Social Listening. I'm still trying to get the idea past my sons. It's terrible to get to this great age and no longer rule the roost. I've got to kowtow to my children. All right, on that sad note, will we move on from this one? I'm going to record that one as a yes, too.
Did we go through all the tools that were mentioned?
Oh, okay. Look, go ahead, guys.
Where did we...
Well, Jim already mentioned Gyroscope. The other one is Node3x. To connect with people, to connect with key people. So, Node3x is a social network analyst tool that helps you build relationships with influential people interested in your topic or niche and grow your reach.
It's built by Lee Smallwood in the UK. It's something that I've tried to get my head around a couple of times. It has rave reviews from the Mutual Admiration Society. I haven't had enough time to really get my head around it, but evidently it's very well received. Did I say something wrong? Have we covered all the tools now, Masataki?
Have we?
No. Have I made you cross?
No. I'm just slightly lost.
Which tools are you using, Masataki?
Not much. The only thing that I use is Hootsuite and TweetDeck. That's about it. So, yeah, I have no idea about tools.
Let's move on to the next one, eh?
Yeah, let's.
Okay. All right. This one was posted by... let's jump to question 5 on our run list because it's a bit of fun. This is... we'll come back to the post about Facebook announcing Facebook Media. Because Tony McCreath posted it, and he did tell me that he may be late, but then again, he did lie to me about the time, Masataki. So who knows?
I don't think he lied. I think he might have been confused.
Okay. Well, anyway, let's go instead to number 5 on our run list, which is San Francisco restaurant turns the tables on Yelp. And this is absolutely so cute. The owner of a San Francisco restaurant is fed up with what he alleges are mafia-style extortion tactics by Yelp. He's decided to fight back by incentivizing patrons to leave as many one-star reviews as possible, with the aspiration of becoming the worst-reviewed restaurant in San Francisco. And it sounds like the move might be paying off for him in free publicity, although Yelp is threatening to take action. And apparently it's recommended you should click through to read the reviews, which read like many of the best parody Amazon reviews. He on his chalkboard in his shop, how people ask for a little bit or extra or just something to dip or splash. He charges $3 for all those things that people normally try to welch for free. And then the other half of his chalkboard, I'll put it on the screen here. I should have done that before. Sorry about that. There we are. Hopefully this chalkboard is going to display on this clip. In it he says, "We don't have ice, we don't have butter, we don't have lemon, we don't have ranch, whatever that is. We don't change TV channels, we charge for bread, what can you do?" And the answer is, hate us on Yelp. And get 25% off any pizza for your one-star review. I can see that working. I can see that working very well. What do you guys think?
It is worth reading through some of the reviews. They are absolutely hilarious. You know, following the link. And yeah, I mean, they're having controversies about Yelp, and they're having many allegations about their tactics. And it's an it's innovative and a fun way to sort of, you know, to how should I put it, to have things upside down. It's good publicity, and it seems to be working. Why not?
Edwin?
Well, it's a little bit of guerrilla marketing, yeah, no?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, well done. It worked.
Mm-hmm. Yes, there should be more of it. Okay, so it looks like Tony's not turning up. So let's go back to number four on our run list, which is the series stuff. It's Facebook announces Facebook Media, a new hub full of best practice advice useful to anyone who uses Facebook as a marketing tool. Facebook today rolled out Facebook Media. And it goes on to say, Facebook Media is filled with best practice advice, much of which applies to anyone using Facebook as a marketing tool. Interesting posts to check out. Drive referrals to your digital properties is on Facebook.com. Engage fans on Facebook, also on Facebook.com or FB.com. Tell rich stories with Facebook video. I guess that's... fighting back against engagement ads on YouTube for Google Plus posts. And is this something that Tony McCreath has posted? I missed that. He said he's going to grab that raging bull by the horns. Heavens above. Your thoughts, guys?
I think it's a very sort of neat set of suggestions and best practices. If you, for example, click on drive referrals to your digital properties, then I think it lists about 12 things that you can do. And some of them might seem obvious or, you know, common practice, but still it's they're quite good to read anyway. So just to go through the 12 points quickly, firstly, post frequently. Secondly, share links, photos, and a variety of content, so diversity of content. Three, upload videos to Facebook with a call to action. Four, create content with social context in mind. Five, tag other pages in your Facebook posts. Six, host a Q&A. Seven, build around your stars, whether TV talent, writers, or public figures. Eight, use trending to find popular topics on Facebook and post about them. Nine, embed Facebook or Instagram posts in your website. 10, add the like and share buttons to your website and mobile apps. 11, add open graph and uplinks tags. And 12, add Facebook comments to your website. I mean, some are in, with reference to Facebook in particular, and of course trying to promote Facebook entities, but you know, they seem to be a sensible set of suggestions to work on.
Okay, it looks as though that's Tony saying I'm a bit inspired to go back to Facebook and see if I can take that traffic-driving bull by its horns. There is no doubt about it. You can put billions of people on a single platform and not be able to develop some marketing out of it. It is a powerful tool. I think I've said in the past that we have one client that doesn't have a website. Their Facebook page provides all that they need. By the way, actually, in social media, I've got something topical to say. Now, very clever marketing by this exact same company, which is using Facebook as their main hub, if you like, or main focus of interest. This week, I'd love to meet whoever's driving their marketing, because it sounds great. This week, they went out and found the 10 highest Instagram users, female, because this is basically a yoga gym. It's a yoga accessories and clothing outlet, cosmetic outlet. You know the drill. You guys know the drill. So they got the top Instagram posters, some with 10,000 followers, some with 30,000 followers, and they brought them in for an event. These people turned up for nothing, and in return for turning up, they did things like a massage. They did things like a jewelry making course, like on the day. What else did they do? All stuff related around their business. Forgive me, I haven't gone to a yoga gym before, Edwin, otherwise I'll be able to tell you more. But anyway, so in other words, they've got the influencers, the thought leaders to an event to do nothing else but participate in all of the products, all of the things that they have for sale. And then they gave them all a goodie bag. You know, that makes me think of Tim Capper giving all of those journos goodie bags full of Godiva chocolates. But in their case, it was goodie bags full of cosmetics and yoga clothing and so on. The entire event cost them $800 to get these people there. And of course, you know, what they will get from it, the return on that $800 investment, will be measured in tens or hundreds, maybe even thousands, who knows. But the thing is that it's just absolutely brilliant. Didn't cost a lot. Thinking outside the square, well, I don't know. I suppose that's what's happening around the world now. But certainly in my world, it's thinking outside the square. Absolutely amazing stuff. And so that's my contribution for the day. Come on, Masataki, it wasn't that good.
Sounds like great marketing, and I think that's it's a great idea, and in the sense that the important thing is how you then connect that to your online properties and entities. And I think something like Facebook / Instagram might work well in that environment, because it's likely that your potential audience would be one or two degrees away from you, as it were. And if you could get influencers like that, then the potential reach is enormous.
Of course, you'd need a social media tool for that to be able to track down the influences that are in your location so that you can invite them. I mean, it's no good asking somebody from Sweden to come. You want someone, I mean, this business is on the Gold Coast of Australia, and so you'd have to be able to first drill into the influences on Instagram and then establish where they are. To a certain extent, you do that on Google Plus using CirculoScope. But that's reliant on people actually entering their location. I'd say only about 1 in 10 actually do enter their location on their profile. But I don't know the tool that you would use to, and again, that's what I'm lunch with whoever's doing these marketing.
Well, I think the hard part in that story is how to reach out to those influencers and not be seen as spam.
Well, yeah. I don't know about that because if they're being asked to come and partake and receive physical gifts. Then and there's no fear of contravening Google guidelines because they don't even care about having a website. If I was the recipient of a message like that and I had the time available and a pair of yoga pants, I'd probably go. No, I wouldn't. Hang on, I can give you an example of marketing, which I don't think is spam. Just hang on, I'll back in 1 second.
Because you cannot come on social media and reach out to all the influencers, look at what a great product I have. I don't think that's going to work.
I'm sorry, Evan, I don't follow what you mean.
Well, if you don't have any connection with the influencers or some shared interest or what have you, if you didn't build any relationship and you just sent a message, join us for a demonstration or get free products, or it might be hard to get to those influencers. No,
I think it depends on the value of the enticement. Look, if it's a trivial thing, then it could be taken to be insulting, I guess. But if it's a substantial and a worthwhile thing, and also happens to be like one thing that was mentioned was that they like the clothing line, and some of them already wear the clothing line, so that they know the value of the goods. I don't think that that would be viewed as spam if the value of the gift was not trivial. I would totally agree that if you tried to label this or cheapskate it, you'd come unstuck.
Most of them were already customers then, so there was already a relationship between the company and the influence.
Not necessarily, because the clothing line is available from other outlets as well. Anyway, look, I'll show you my thing. See this here. This was sent to me. It's an Ausdom, AUSDOM.com. They have got the most beautiful website I've ever seen in my life. Have a look at it and tell me if you disagree. But anyway, this is Osdon 2. It rotates 360 this way and up and down this way. And I have a purpose for this. It's just that all I need is the time to set it up. I've had it now for, well, actually it arrived when I was heading off for Fraser Island. And so sort of with that week off, I've been trying to catch up on work, so I just haven't had time to install. But when I do get time, this is going to be monitoring our front door, which is outside of my sight when I'm working. And anyway, it's going to be a marvellous thing, and I will be more than happy to show how I am. All they've asked is that I show how I use it. To me, I don't think that's insulting. I mean, it's going to take more of my time to do it than it would cost to buy it. But you know, it's arrived here, and it's a good product, and I like it. And as I say, the only reason it's still on my desk is because I haven't had time to install it. I think that is good marketing, and certainly for me anyway. I don't know any better way. Your thoughts?
Me neither, Jim.
Would you like one of these, Edwin? I can put in a good word for you.
I'm looking at the site, and they have some really good ideas for security cameras in stores. Those cameras you normally buy for your store, they are just expensive. And at least here in the Netherlands, you lease them from a company. If you can have multiple cameras on one screen, that will be a cheap solution.
Supply security cameras to clients at around the $700 mark. I just realized what I've done. I think we're going to have to mark this video for product placement.
Oh.
Damn it. Let me figure it out. I'll do it after the hangout. But I lost my train of thought now. What were we up to?
You were saying that the normal security cameras are $700.
What price is that on the Osdom.com site?
$130, but that's on sale. Normally it's $200.
Yeah, well, I mean, if it's as durable as cameras that we normally sell to clients, and I certainly think it will be, it feels that way, there's another reason for them to send it to us, because Blair saw this walking past my desk, and he was quite taken with it. What are the rules, Masataki, on product placement on YouTube videos?
I have absolutely no idea.
I know I have to make a declaration before I publish that there is no product placement. I have to say there is a box to fill in. This hangout contains product placement. And I don't know the definition of product placement, but I think that this would fit it, wouldn't it?
I think so too, yeah. You showed the product. Yeah. You said how good it was.
You haven't even put a plug in it yet.
True. And we also mentioned the price, by the way. So I'm pretty sure this product placement now.
Okay, so here it
I
is.
I even said it was on sale, so.
Ausdom.com. AUSDOM.com. Okay, so I'll go and click that button, product placement. Okay, all right. Have we covered everything?
I think so.
Looks that way.
All right. We still have viewers, and we thank you for taking an interest in what we do, because your participation is what you do makes what we do worthwhile, and we thank you for that. We'll be back same time next week to do it over again, and thank you for watching.